everyone. Selamat siang semuanya. Kurang semangat nih. Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, welcome to Air America. Selamat datang di Air America. Ada yang sudah pernah ke Air America sebelumnya? Boleh angkat tangan yang sudah pernah? Berarti rata-rata most of you have never been here before, right? Okay, so I would like to give a very brief introduction about what At America is. So At America is an American center by the U.S. Embassy Jakarta, where in here you can explore and also experience United States through our high-tech facilities and also our cool events. Di sini kalian bisa belajar lebih banyak tentang Amerika Serikat melalui gadget-gadget yang mutakhir yang kita miliki di At America. Kita punya 3D printer display, ada juga Google Earth Liquid Galaxy, di mana kalian bisa jalan-jalan keliling dunia secara virtual. Then we also have iPads that we use as our digital library. Jadi kalau nanti mau eksplor tempat ini, boleh jalan-jalan setelah acara ini selesai. Dan selain itu, kita juga punya banyak sekali event-event yang sangat menarik yang bisa kalian datangi secara gratis. Apa saja event-eventnya? Ada yang suka musik di sini? Ada yang suka nonton konser musik gratis? Boleh angkat tangan? Banyak ya, semuanya mau suka nonton konser musik, terutama yang gratis. So if you guys want to watch a music concert for free, you can just come to At America, because we're going to have tribute At America, Foo Fighters, that will be happening on this Friday, tanggal 5 Juni 2015 pada pukul 6.30 sampai dengan 8.30. Akan ada 77, salah satu band Indonesia yang akan membawakan lagu-lagu dari Foo Fighters. Then, if you guys like to play drum and you guys really want to be a drummer, you can come to this workshop. Kita akan ada workshop Drumming is for Everyone yang akan diadakan pada hari Sabtu 13 Juni 2015 pada pukul 2 sampai dengan jam 4 sore. Di sana kita akan belajar dari Indonesian drummer and also music lecturer, yaitu Bapak Denny, Mas Denny AJD, dan beliau akan mengajarkan bagaimana caranya menjadi drummer dan teknik-teknik bermain drum. Jadi langsung saja datang hari Sabtu besok. Selain dari acara-acara tersebut, fasilitas yang menjadi unggulan dari At America adalah Education USA. Di mana di Education USA, kalian yang bermimpi atau berkeinginan untuk melanjutkan pendidikan di Amerika Serikat, you guys can ask our Education USA advisor, karena beliau bisa membantu untuk memberikan informasi tentang menempuh pendidikan di Amerika Serikat dan juga peluang-peluang beasiswa yang mungkin bisa kalian dapatkan. Bagaimana caranya? Langsung saja datang ke Education USA Corner di At America. She is available from Tuesday to Friday from 1 to 9 p.m. Dan di hari Sabtu, kalian bisa berkonsultasi mulai dari jam 10 sampai dengan jam 9 malam. At America sudah berdiri sejak 2 Desember 2010 dan sudah lebih dari ribuan event yang diadakan di At America. Berikut adalah gambar-gambar atau foto-foto dari acara-acara yang pernah diadakan di At America. Kita pernah kedatangan Menteri Luar Negeri Amerika Serikat, Bapak John Kerry, ada Nadia Hutagalung, ada yang kenal ini siapa? Miss Universe pernah kesini juga, ada Bumblefoot, gitaris dari Guns N' Roses, bahkan Iron Man pernah main ke At America. So if you guys are interested to come to our event, how to get updates about our event, it's very easy. Kalau mau dapat update tentang acara-acara yang ada di At America, all you have to do is just becoming our member. How to become our member? Kalian tinggal pergi saja ke www.atamerica.or.id and then you click register dan masukkan nama dan juga email addressnya, alamat email kalian, dan nanti satu minggu sekali kami akan kirimkan update berisi acara-acara yang akan diadakan di At America. And all of our events are free and you don't need to register yourself to come to our event. And don't forget to also get updates from our social media. You can follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/ATAmerica, and then later if you mention us and also use the hashtag @America, your tweets will be appear on our tweet wall. Sepertinya sudah banyak ya nih yang nge-tweet tentang acara-acara hari ini. Keep tweeting and also don't forget to like our fan page juga di Facebook, di facebook.com/itamerica, karena nanti semua dokumentasi acara hari ini akan kita upload di Facebook tersebut. So, without further ado, I would like to invite our moderator for today's discussion, Mr. Kali Ruter, Chief Economist for Bakrie Group. So please welcome Mr. Kali Ruter.
Terima kasih, Mbak. Iya, iya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We meet again to discuss very heavy stuff, yeah, very difficult and but very important stuff. Again, brought to you by Bakrie Center Foundation. I'd like to invite Mr. Andreas Lis from the EU Commission here. Pak Ibrahim from our Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And joining us online will be another person. His name is not up here, is he? Mr. Tamsek? Can you hear us?
Okay. Yes.
Okay, thank you. It's okay, Pak. No problem. Okay, we are going to discuss, apparently, this is a perennial topic, yeah, something that has been discussed over and over again, but for some of you, this may be new, and I'm just wondering, should I speak in Bahasa or in English? How good is your Bahasa, Andreas? Okay. Mr. Tamsek, I don't suppose your Bahasa is very good, so we'll do this in English then. Is it okay with all of you?
Please speak in English.
Okay.
If not, I have to answer in Thai.
Okay. From time to time, I will switch to Indonesian, and I will allow our audience to interact with you in Indonesian, which I can translate if necessary. So our topic again is, what lessons EU can bring to ASEAN? Yeah? Because our context is ASEAN. We are very provincial, unfortunately, still. So we look into our nearest community, which is the ASEAN community, and would like to discuss what lessons can be learned. Mr. Termsak, Chalerm Palanupap, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly.
Yes.
Is a lead researcher, a senior researcher, a political and security affairs analyst, currently a visiting research fellow at ICWA in Singapore. Formerly, he was with the ASEAN Secretariat for over 20 years, from 1993 onwards. And he has a lot of experience in government and international affairs. He holds a PhD from the University of New Orleans. Mr. Andreas, our guest from the EU office, is currently the head of the office in Indonesia. He's also the resident representative. Is that the same thing? More or less, yeah. But you don't get double salary, do you? Okay, they pay once. Okay, he was formerly the principal administrator at External Relations Directorate at the European Commission, and a lot of experience in the European Commission. Mr. Ibrahim Yusuf is the chairman of ICWA, which is the Indonesian Council on World Affairs. Formerly, Mr. Ibrahim was the ambassador, Indonesian ambassador to Thailand, and ambassador to Dubai, if I'm not mistaken, but Abu Dhabi. Okay, sorry. Forgive my ignorance. So this is our agenda for today is quite complex. And if you remember, and you've been reading the newspaper, there's becoming important in the sense that ASEAN recently has seen an increase in the tension among a few countries within ASEAN with one country which will remain nameless for some reasons, which in there, this guy is very, these people are very sensitive, so we shouldn't mention it. But a most recent comment by the president of the Philippines, yeah, Benigno Nino, Ninoy Aquino, the son of the late Ninoy Aquino, recently mentioned, which later he retracted, the situation now in ASEAN is the same as pre-war Europe. Almost like what happened during the 30s leading up to the Second World War. And then, of course, he retracted that statement, but the damage has been done. I mean, the glass is broken, yeah. So he may be referring to whatever is happening in South China Sea. And of course, Indonesia is very well aware of this situation, and people are wondering, where is ASEAN in this? Yeah. At the same time, in Europe, there is also a lot of news regarding Greece. Not the EU per se, but pertaining to the EU. Maybe later Mr. Andreas will elaborate on what is actually going on and what it means for the EU going forward. So, again, I shouldn't belabor the point, but of course ASEAN and EU are very different groups of countries, each with its own history and so on, and where we are going maybe different paths, yeah? But of course there are lessons in integration that we can learn from EU. So without further ado, let me start with Mr. Andreas. What do you think is the main lessons from EU, which I think it started in the 1990s, early 90s or late 80s, yeah, and it has evolved in its format from political to economic and so on. What have you learned from the EU experiment or EU experience?
Selamat sore. Does it work? That makes you speechless. So, Selamat sore, thank you very much for the kind invitation. I'm really glad that I can say a few words about one of the most wonderful and most successful peace experiments and prosperity experiments that mankind has seen, namely the European Union. Well, what are the lessons that to be learned? The lessons to be learned today are actually twofold. When the EU was created after the Second World War, Europe was flattened by war. It was a fratricidal war. And we said, and some of our far-sighted leaders said, never again such a war. How can we prevent it? It's not enough to say, let's do peace. What do you do for that? You integrate your economy. You have this spillover effect that your economy will hang together and you will be entangled with your neighbors and it will be impossible to go to war again. That was the initial justification of the EU and it's still valid. Later on, the EU in the 1990s became increasingly a political project. Today the EU is a sort of a federation, if you want, less federated than the US, but still a political entity. And I would say today, and this is one of the lessons for ASEAN, today the EU has a response to a chaotic, unpredictable global environment. Our globalized, digitalized world becomes so difficult to understand that it becomes almost obvious to see regional integration as an intelligent answer to our increasingly complex world. This is, I think, one of the arguments that would hold true for ASEAN as well.
On to our ASEAN counterparts. Mr. Jamlak, what do you see as challenges in ASEAN that we can pluck or can take or pick from EU, which you think can be used for ASEAN? I mean, given the current context of ASEAN.
Well, certainly, Mr. Andreas made a very good point that we must do more economic cooperation. Economic cooperation will bring prosperity. But in ASEAN, we try, but we do not have enough resources to actually implement our economic cooperation agreements. And that is our serious shortcoming. We learned from the European Union that to build a successful common market, they need a lot of resources. To have cohesion in Europe, they need a lot of money, a lot of euro to help the poorer country to develop. I just look at the budget of the European Union this year. The European Union will have about 145 billion euro for community building. But how much ASEAN has for community building in ASEAN? We don't have any resources for community building. That is a serious problem. And we should learn from the European Union that building a community requires resources.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Jamlak. That's a very good argument. Comparing these two groups of countries, yeah, it is very clear that Europe has a very strong commitment to the Secretariat, let's put it that way, or whoever is at the center of this. And I've been a customer, you could say that, of Eurostat. One of the outputs of the so-called Secretariat, one of the centers in Europe, which is a very good, has very good reputation. Maybe, Ibrahim, you can explain a little bit, why is ASEAN's commitment to the ASEAN Secretariat very low? Is it by nature of the ASEAN structure, or is it because each particular member do not see what is the purpose of my assisting the center or the secretariat, for example?
I think there is now a new thinking now to strengthen the ASEAN Secretariat also, on how ASEAN Secretariat also could design from the planning up to the operationalization of any programs of ASEAN. But back to the first question, if you permit me to give comments. That's we look to European Union. The integration in European Union as a terms of said requires a lot of funds. That's why European Union established what they call structural funds. ASEAN we don't have kind of structural funds. And then before the enlargement also of the European Union to the new members, from what it calls the core members of the European Union, the advanced ones, like France, Germany, Netherlands, and then the peripheries, Italy, Greece, and Portugal. They have a cohesion strategy. While the enlargement of ASEAN, I think we don't introduce this kind of the cohesion strategy when we enlarge, the accession of the Brunei in 1994, and then in the Chinese countries also, Myanmar, Laos. This is, I think, we don't have. So I think we look to this in the future on how we could, especially on the narrowing the gaps between the core of ASEAN. Five countries before, and then the new members in this CLMP, Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Vietnam. This kind of structural fund, I think we should look into. It's also the cohesion fund, and how we could financing the gaps between the cores of ASEAN and then the new members of ASEAN. It's the member. Because the difference with European Union, we more rely on the outsider, I mean the assistance from dialogue partners like Australia or Japan or South Korea for financing the projects. And it's also from the regional institution like ASEAN Development Bank, ADB, to finance the GMS projects, you know, or the growth triangles between Indonesia, Thailand, and Malaysia, or Sijori, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore. I think a lot of the infusion of money, but I think we rely on the third parties. It's, I think, they're quite different between European Union and ASEAN.
Yeah, there have been a lot of debate on this. One of the reasons they say that the ASEAN cohesion, let's put it that way, is different from Europe, besides the fact of history, is because the ASEAN leadership or the political history of independence have made ASEAN countries very fiercely, I mean, the feeling of sovereignty is very strong in ASEAN. Yeah, the feeling of being independent is very strong. One of the reasons is because a couple of ASEAN countries have recently became independent after the Second World War. So this feeling of a strong identity, independence, have hampered the creation of a stronger or a more cohesive union. But if you look at on the other side, yeah, the economic rationale of ASEAN coming together is actually there. Two reasons. One is symmetry, meaning that, for instance, Indonesia and Malaysia, and to some extent Thailand, are commodity exporters. So whatever happens to commodity prices will impact us more or less the same. At the same time, a couple of other countries are complementary, meaning that we export stuff to Singapore and we import stuff from Singapore and so on. So there's these two different distinct but related concepts which actually should lead to a stronger cohesion. Yeah? And to some extent, we are going in that direction in 2015. Yeah, although maybe Mr. Chamlak can elucidate a little bit, can explain a bit. Is this actually making us closer, or is it actually becoming somewhat problematic? Because some countries, like for instance, there are voices in Indonesia saying that we are not ready for this. We are surrendering some degree of sovereignty if we enter into ASEAN economic community. And if to be blunt, the recent government speeches, Mr. Widodo, apparently is moving in the direction of nationalistic policies. There have been even people saying that Indonesia is moving away from ASEAN. Would you care to comment on this?
Yes, one big difference between ASEAN and the European Union is that in ASEAN, we don't have Germany, we have Indonesia. In European Union, Germany benefits from economic integration, and therefore Germany is willing to contribute more. In ASEAN, the financial responsibility is always on the basis of equal sharing. Big or small, poor or rich, every member state in ASEAN shares an equal contribution to ASEAN. And that's why we have difficulty when we talk about resource mobilization. Another point to make is that sovereignty is given. Nobody questions sovereignty, national interest. But when we participate in ASEAN, we have a new responsibility as a regional partner in ASEAN. Therefore, we must pay attention to regional commitment. We must come up with a better balance between national interest sovereignty and fulfilling our regional responsibility. Because every member government in ASEAN voluntarily enter into ASEAN and make ASEAN agreements, once they have agreed to do something, then it has a responsibility to implement. And I think when we talk about sovereignty, we should also talk about regional commitment, common interest in ASEAN. They should come together in a good balance.
Right. Maybe Mr. Andreas, you can now look from outside, looking in to ASEAN. Yeah. There's this concerns, like for instance, ASEAN, even intra-ASEAN, like for instance, Indonesia and Malaysia have some problems, some bilateral problems. Yeah. And if I remember correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, ASEAN has explicitly stated that it will not enter into bilateral or trilateral problems, only when the issue is common to all ASEAN members will the ASEAN entity talk about it, you know, or do something about it. But if it is a bilateral issue inside or outside between ASEAN members and a third country, the ASEAN will not enter into the picture. That is my understanding. Yeah. Maybe you can comment on this. I mean, is this? I mean, I'm not saying it's correct or not correct, but the way we are at the moment here, back to the original question as to why we have not contributed a lot of resources to the Secretariat. Is this because of the sovereignty issue or something else? I don't know.
Thank you for that. I think so far we have covered a lot of ground, and a lot of good arguments have been voiced. One was history. History matters, but history matters only to a certain extent. Otherwise, we would be prisoners of history. Nobody prevents us from thinking beyond what we have now. The second thing is this. It is wrong to believe that there's a kind of an automatic evolution. Like, you push the integration button, and regional integration goes on, and then automatically at one point you will reach a level where you are as integrated as the European Union. I think that's fundamentally wrong. There is no such automatic history trajectory that leads you to a certain model of integration. So if there is no model of integration to follow, the question of sovereignty becomes a different one. And I would propose a more constructive approach than the old talk, shall ASEAN copy the EU or not? Now, some people would say yes, and some people would say no, and some people would say yes but, and some people would say no, except if and when. This is not very productive. Look at the reality around us. We have issues to cover. Issues. So what are the issues that we are facing? And you can compare them, and then you find maybe areas where you find yourself in a deficit and where you should be more ambitious. Before we talk about the economy, let's talk about politics. Let's talk about domestic peace, peace among us. Yeah. Thailand, Indonesia, Germany, France, and so on and so on. Peace within the family. Have we been successful in the EU? Yes, very much. The EU is and remains a peace project. War has become an inconceivable phenomenon within the European Union and among its members. How about ASEAN? I would say roughly similar. ASEAN was at the beginning, ASEAN was instigated and installed for peace reasons to stop the confrontation between Indonesia and Malaysia. Go one step further. Peace at our doorstep, in our environment. What is the Ukraine for the European Union could be the South China Sea for ASEAN. at our doorstep an area where you see political rivalries. Is the EU active? Yes, very much so. In the Ukraine case, in the Mediterranean refugee crisis case, the EU is proactive and trying to address the issue. The EU presents a rather coherent political image. Does ASEAN do the same in the context of regional conflict? I'll leave it to you. There's the question of soft power. The EU is admittedly not a hard power. It's not about military force in the first place. There's a military element to the EU, but not in the first place. It's about soft power, the power of convening, the power of arguments, the power of dialogue. Has ASEAN an equivalent level of argument, of discourse? I would say there ASEAN could be more ambitious. And only then we come to the economic sphere. You would say, has the EU brought economic prosperity? The answer is yes. Don't say there's a crisis because of the EU. There's a crisis, there are challenges. Think about Greece and Portugal and other countries. But these crises, these issues are not about the European Union. This is about the irresponsible behavior of national governments. And believe me, you overcome these issues with more Europe, not with less. So what we need in Europe is a stronger European Union. That could be a lesson for ASEAN. Okay? And the final argument, I would say, is governance. An increasing integration process, an accelerating integration process, requires automatically, I would say, some increase in public participation. People want to hear from their governments what they're doing. They want some transparent governance, rule of law, accountability. Do we have that in the EU? The answer is yes. Do you have it in ASEAN? I would say there is an increasing civil society engagement and commitment and organization. I was 3 weeks ago at the ASEAN summit in Kiel, and in parallel you had an ASEAN's people forum, which was a very strong and powerful outfit. So I would say if you look at integration processes, not so much as models, as we say, but as responses to challenges, then you will find out where the deficits are and where achievements, where progress has been made.
Okay, thank you. That's a very illuminating argument, Mr. Andreas. Maybe Pa Ibrahim can look at how has ASEAN advanced Indonesia's interests, for example. How have we benefited from the presence of ASEAN to convince people to have more engagement with ASEAN?
I think so. We look in from the perspective of politics and strategy before, because the establishment of ASEAN also to create the regional stability surrounding in Indonesia. That's why Indonesia mentioned that ASEAN is the main pillars of Indonesian foreign policy. Because when Indonesia want to develop further, especially on our drive for national economic development, we need the beneficial surroundings, a conducive security environment around us. It is one the benefit from the strategic point of view of ASEAN for Indonesia. And then, of course, from the economic integration, so things, we could more draw the investment for Indonesia. Now, Singapore, yeah, from the within ASEAN, only the first country that invested more, and then followed by Malaysia and then in Thailand. So there we can benefit also the investment from the ASEAN, the other Asian countries on how, you know, we move forward there. in our economic development in the future. This is another thing is together with the other members of the country, we could together on how we deal with the other countries, with the international organization like WTO, where we are together in the United Nations, we are together. And then, but the problems with compared to the European Union, we don't have a kind of the Maastricht Treaty on common foreign and security policy together. We don't have this kind of mechanism on how we coordinate more our policy, because it is very, very difficult.
By the way, if I may interrupt you, should you have it?
Yes, it is here, but that pretty difficult to make the common foreign policy. For instance, our nation foreign policy and diplomacy toward Israel, very different, and our perception with Malaysia, not Malaysia, I think we have the same boat with Malaysia and Brunei with regard to Israel, for instance. But with Thailand, with Singapore, I think we have different perspectives. This can, but on a selective basis, I think on a certain issues, I think, like the South China Sea, for instance, I think we mobilize the same policy. When we are now negotiating on the COC with China, I think we have a code of conduct. I think we have the common platform here. With regard to COC with China. Although Indonesia is not, we don't have any overlapping claims with China.
Okay. Yeah, Mr. Chamlak, how do you see ASEAN evolving with the current challenges? Yeah, one with the political issue, and second is the ASEAN Economic Community coming online later this year or probably next year. And also the integration of our capital markets and so on. So apparently there is some forward movement in ASEAN, yeah? Probably not as fast as some people would like, and the direction may not be to everyone's liking, but there is some progress taking place. How do you see this going forward?
Well, certainly ASEAN community building is progressing, and that's why we are actively preparing to go into the next roadmap from 2016 to 2025. I would like to go back to the question about governance and public participation. I think this is something still missing in ASEAN that we should learn from the European Union. How we will make ASEAN community beneficial to the people, I think that is a very important question. We cannot build a community without involving our ASEAN people. I think that is a very fundamental issue. But so far, I think ASEAN government do not pay much attention to this question just yet. But we already have a new ASEAN communication master plan, and we have the ASEAN Foundation. But there is no money to implement the communication master plan. There is no money to help ASEAN Foundation promote public awareness. So if the people don't know about ASEAN, don't understand why we have to build a community, then it's no use trying to say we want to have a new roadmap. I think that is a very important issue that we have to look into. But Ibrahim mentioned about common ASEAN foreign policy. That is another issue we should learn from the European Union. It is very difficult to make it work. Even the European Union doesn't have a common policy on how to deal with Russia, for example, or how to fight the war in Afghanistan. So I don't think we need to go into that common foreign policy. But our leader already agreed that by the year 2022, actually this is an Indonesian initiative, by the year 2022, ASEAN shall create an ASEAN common platform so that all the ASEAN government can come together to formulate common policy toward major global issues. I think that is a very important commitment, and I hope that it will be realized, not forgotten.
Okay, thank you, sir. I think we have time for discussion with the audience. We have about 20 minutes of time. Let me open the floor to the left wing, the left side of the chamber here. Any questions from your side? You can also bisa bahasa Indonesia juga. Saya bahasa Indonesia saya cukup bagus.
Saya juga.
And we can translate for you. No problem. Silakan kalau ada pertanyaan mengenai EU atau ASEAN yang ingin Anda silakan, silakan. Tolong sebutkan nama dan dari mana ya, Mas?
Good afternoon. I'm Ali. I'm a editor for hukumonline.com. I try to speak in English, although my English is not good. I hope you understand my question. I want to add this discussion with a more legal perspective. Like, as I work as an editor for news who focus on legal issue, we see European Union is like a new kind of like transnational law. We think like that, and in legal in law perspective, in Indonesia, there's a debate between the constitutional law expert and international expert. What the future of ASEAN would be? Should we follow the European Union or not? Like, for international expert, think that yeah, we just like this, like ASEAN, just like ASEAN right now. Like, it's like yeah, we just need consensus. We just talk with others. There's no legally binding policy like European Union. But for constitutional law expert, thinks that we should follow the European Union because we need to extend like more policy. My question is, which actually for the moderator who's you are the economist, right?
I hope so.
Expert. Yeah, it's all for you. Like, which one is better for economic perspective? Should we follow the concept of transnational law, transnational, or it's just like ASEAN right now? Like, we just do ASEAN way, like just consensus, we just talk, we just discuss, and there's no legally binding policy for each member. Which one is better for economic? And the second question is, actually I want to hear United States perspective about this issue, because as we know, the establishment of a European Union become like the competitor of United States, right? So like, there's no superpower anymore. I want to ask your opinion, Mr. Andreas, about I don't know, what do you think about United States? Do they agree if ASEAN follow the European Union concept, or just ASEAN like we see right now? I hope my question is
okay,
clear.
Quite very clear. Very
okay,
clear.
Thank you.
Anyone else from the left wing? Okay, we'll take another question.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator and distinguished guest. My name is Gidan Al-Ghifari. I'm a high school student, and I would like to ask two questions. So hearing the news about South China Sea conflict, which is kind of relevant with the Ukraine and Russia conflicts, I would like to ask Mr. Andreas especially, because in the status quo, ASEAN is less political than the European Union. We don't have like European Union parliamentary. We don't have like NATO, like a military treaty. So is it necessary for ASEAN to possess such entities, such as the parliamentary and military treaty, because we are now facing the emerging China in our doors, and this issue has become more blazing than ever. We have seen casualties in Philippines, in Vietnam, and I really fear that it will also even come to our nation, Indonesia. So I would like to ask your opinion about this argument. And the second is, ASEAN is also an economic entity, which in the end of this year, we will reach the due date of ASEAN Community 2015. My question is, will we be ready to have the ASEAN currency such as European Union? European Union have euro, right? But now in ASEAN, we don't have that. We don't have a common currency such as Indonesia have rupiah and Singapore have Singapore dollar. So to what extent that ASEAN need such currency, and how are we ready to face that opportunity? Thank you.
Okay, I think we should start with these two questions first. One is from Mr. Ali, the legality side. I guess this question is addressed to me. But you people can have a go at it first. And then second question is the US perspective. I suppose someone has mentioned early in the EU experience that EU is something like the states in the United States with a common currency, central government, but not up to that point. I mean, not to that extreme. Yeah, there's some sovereignty left. Maybe you might want to comment on that.
Yes. To respond to the question of Pa'ali, let's say whether a supranational outfit, as we call it, or an intergovernmental outfit is better for economic development, whether you need a strong EU or whether strong member states, as in ASEAN, are better in the long term for economic development. I would say we shouldn't make an ideology out of this question. It's more a pragmatic response that I would like to give. On balance, I would say a stronger European type of setup makes a lot of sense. European law takes precedence or priority over national law. And that is one, that's a key achievement. That's on balance positive. But the main point, and that leads to your second question, is something else. It's about what do you want to achieve? Again, it's about issues, not about a theoretical concept. What do you want to achieve? If you want to achieve prosperity, you can't do that by, for instance, seeking inspiration from the EU's regional policy. I give a very simple sort of explanation of what is regional policy is about. You take the regions of your area. So you don't talk about 28 EU member states. You talk about roughly 150 regions. And you will see that are in richer countries, there are also poorer regions. In poorer countries, there are richer regions. So you compare the regions, and then you enter in this big table. How many gynecologists do you have per 1 million people? How many high school places do you have for 1 million students? How many asphalt roads, kilometers, and so on, so on. You have dozens and dozens and dozens of parameters, how you measure regions. And then you take an average. If you're below the 100% average, you get support from the EU in the areas that you are failing. If you're below 75% of the average, you get fundamental support. EU regional policy is a tremendous and widely underexposed success story. I remember some years ago, I spent holidays in Ireland, my family. And Ireland was one of the biggest beneficiaries of EU regional policy. And every time we came to a bridge, there was a big billboard that said, bridge funded by the regional fund of the European Union. And then we came to a road and the billboard said, road funded by the European Union. And that went on for days and days. And at one point we come to a bridge and there was no billboard. And my children said, Daddy, what's wrong with that bridge? So you see, Ireland has tremendously benefited from the EU, from regional policy. This is something that you can do in ASEAN, or you should, I think, do in ASEAN without entering into the question whether a supranational outfit is better or not. And then, if I may, and jump ahead and answer the last question, whether ASEAN would need a parliamentary dimension or a military dimension. I would say the parliamentary dimension is inevitable. It will come sooner or later. I mentioned the last ASEAN summit in KL with this very strong show of the ASEAN's People's Forum, where you had an enormous amount of politically constructive energy. These were not negative people or anarchist or revolutionary spirits. These were very constructive people who wanted to move things. And I think governments are very well advised to listen. So the parliamentary dimension, the transparency dimension, the accountability dimension, the governance dimension of ASEAN inevitably needs to be strengthened over time. Whether ASEAN needs a common currency, I'm not so sure that this is hugely important at this moment, and I think you can wait to answer that question for another, let's say, 10, 12, 15 years.
Yeah, referring to the first question, I think this is the difference between European Union and ASEAN. I think the difference in the process, the difference in mechanism, and the difference between the relation or the gaps, the economic gaps with inter members of the EU and ASEAN. We refer to the first question on sovereignty. I think to some extent there is some submission of sovereignty in the European Union to supranational body that we don't have in ASEAN at this stage. The ASEAN charters maintain the sovereignty of ASEAN. But although we don't have this kind of the supranational body coordinating the policy or relation between interstate relation within ASEAN, but the much criticized way of ASEAN, it's what we call the ASEAN way. I think to some extent retains the cohesion of ASEAN. Although I said that slowly, you know, you need consensus. But to some extent, this informal way, to some extent, make ASEAN moving forwards. So with regard to the kind of the single currency, in 2012, there was discussion already on the ASEAN's currency union before by the informal meeting of the ASEAN foreign ministers. But the discussion between within Indonesia, especially those official in the central bank, we are not mature enough, you know, to have this kind of the single currency ASEAN, because there's some coordination of the fiscal policy among ASEAN member countries. The macroeconomic policy should be coordinated among ASEAN member countries. And we don't have a kind of the management of the capital flows within ASEAN. And we don't have also regional financial safety nets if there's something happens, you know. This kind of the some parameters should be prepared before we move into the single currency like European Union. So I think, but all the way, as Mr. Temsak also mentioned, in ASEAN, as also mandated by ASEAN charters, should move toward a people's-oriented ASEAN. This is mandated by the charter, then we should move, really, including the establishment of a kind of this ASEAN parliament. You know, we have now ASEAN's inter-parliament organizations, but it's quite different. The setup is quite different with the European parliaments. Then we don't have also what is called the European Commissions. Yeah, we don't have the ASEAN Commission. A number of the mechanisms I think that have been established long before, and including the European Central Bank. We don't have this ASEAN Central Bank. So a lot of things. But the pointing thing on how we move to the people-oriented ASEAN. I and Ms. Temsap last year, we met here, try to organize multi-tracks efforts on how to propagate ASEAN into the people to different tracks. Mr. Temsap was our guest at the time from this organization in Singapore. So I think there should be a way, you know, ASEAN members, and because Indonesian, the people in the rural area, they don't know ASEAN, you know. Even then, they know, of course, President Jokowi, you know, they know. But when you talk about ASEAN, then what is ASEAN? They know that BBM is rising up, yeah. And then they understand this. So,
okay.
The price of stuff is rising. But when you go, what is ASEAN? They don't know. There should be, our meeting last year here with Mr. Temsak, try on to propagate, to socialize, mensosialisasikan in bahasa Indonesia, on how peoples in the eastern corner of Indonesia could understand about ASEAN, you know. Because 2015, by the end of this, it is the milestone for us, you know, to have this ASEAN community.
Thank you, Pak. Mr. Temsak, would you like to add to...
Yes, I would like to clarify Mr. Ali's question. ASEAN agreement, ASEAN charter, they are legally binding as international agreement. And actually, in our ASEAN charter, we have chapter 8 for dispute settlement in ASEAN. So ASEAN agreement has legal force within every member state. But the problem is we are in an intergovernmental relationship. So the relationship is among governments, and they don't want to bring any legal case against each other. And ASEAN Secretariat has no power to report non-compliance, unlike the European Commission. European Commission has very strong authority to ensure compliance of all of our European agreement. So what we need to do is to continue to build ASEAN institution so that there will be more compliance, more implementation. Without strong ASEAN institution, then there is no point thinking about common currency, because that is a very high level of cooperation activity that require very strong common authority, common institution to enforce rules and regulation. The question about Ukraine, I should like to point out that Ukraine was quite isolated. It has no allies, it has no supporter. But in ASEAN, we are not that isolated. We have a lot of friends near and far. All the major powers are our direct partners. So we don't see any need to have or to turn ourselves into a military alliance against any potential enemy. We don't see anyone as our potential enemy. All the major power are our partner that we hope we can work with them.
Okay, thank you. Regarding the question of constitutional versus international law, as traders or economic players, yeah, commercial players, I think they would prefer to have certainty rather than agreements which people can break at any moment. But again, this is beyond economics. Yeah, this is the purview of politics and legality, yeah, constitutional power. It is not within the sphere of economics. We in economics players, we work within the structure that is given. Currently, the structure is this so-called agreements. Yeah, it is not a legally binding. And also, as mentioned earlier, the ASEAN governments cannot enforce the law in the other country, or the ASEAN Secretariat cannot enforce the law. It is only the national governments which can enforce the law. So, as an example, Indonesia recently sunk a few illegal fishing vessels. So the question is this illegal or is it legal? The question becomes moot because the waters is Indonesian territorial waters and we are working within our legal structure. And if the court or whoever authority says, yes, you can sink the ship, and we sink the ship, it is within the legality of the Indonesian structure. I mean, it will work within the structure. Of course, Thai government might not like this, but I'm sure of it, but But this is within our structure, and we have every right to do that. And with regard to common currency, I think this is a very long discussion. Yeah, I can talk about this for like 3 hours or 5 hours. Yeah, the problem is cycles. Economics is about cycles. If Indonesia wants to increase interest rates because our inflation is rising, at the same time that Singapore wants to reduce interest rates because it wants to jumpstart economic growth, then we are in conflict. Because we have, if we have an ASEAN central bank, where it's only one interest rate, one currency, yeah, and the central bank reduces interest rate, it will be to our disadvantage. But then we have to change the structure of the economy and so on and so forth. So I think it's a very long road, yeah, ahead if going to a single currency. We have to open up the floor to the right side. Can you quickly, unfortunately we have only 1 minute left. Maybe you can quickly come straight to the point.
Thank you. My name is Gerard. I'd like to thank you for allowing this me to give this opportunity to ask questions. I want to ask about the energy policy in the EU concerning renewable resources. That's about biofuels or biodiesels. Does the EU have an energy policy on this? And can we learn from something? Because in Indonesia, we have a lot of plants that can be converted into biofuels, like palm oil. BBC World Service recently told us that even algae, red algae, can be converted into biofuels, like biodiesel. These biodiesel, if it is used in Indonesia, it can be used to power up tractors, traktor tangan, tractors or processing machines for sugar canes especially. And even sugar canes itself can be used as a biofuel. If we have a liberal, a vibrant, thriving biofuel industry, it would create a lot of jobs, it would create a lot of income, and we can power our economy and thus pay through tax, and it can be collected through taxes to build the country like Indonesia. I want to ask, what is the energy policy concerning biofuels, that's renewable resources, in the EU? And can we adopt that policy too, so we can learn, so we can grow our own thriving biofuel industry and create a lot of jobs and move the economy forward? Thank you.
Okay, I'm sorry, I made a mistake. I just looked at the monitor and it initially said 1 minute. Suddenly, magic happened. And now we have 20 minutes. Yeah, so I can allow a second question from this side of the floor. First was energy policy. Okay, energy policy. Yeah, renewable energy policy probably. Yeah.
Thank you. Terima kasih. My name is Yo Budi Monare. I am a lawyer. Okay. Maybe my question is related to Mr. Ali about transnational or something. So, when I read the documents, the ASEAN chapters, it should be mutual benefit, mutual effect, mutual respect, and an equal treatment. But what I have read, it's something unfair in terms of, you know, that Indonesia has so many corruption cases, and some of the economic criminals ran away to Singapore. They hide their monies in the Singapore bank accounts, so much, a huge amount. But in this case, the Singapore government do not want to open that money, that money accounts, and then let alone about their extraditions. So what's the use of having ASEAN if it is only for self-profit, or so they just want to focus on their own interest? So don't forget, and if this happens again and again, it will be in disintegrating power. So does this similar case happen in EU? And what did the EU government do? If not, what's your suggestion, especially Mr. Andreas? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So we have two questions, very interesting questions. One is about energy, renewable energy policy, lessons probably from EU and what ASEAN can do. Second is with corruption and banking secrecy probably, yeah? I'm not so sure about the extradition. Is there any extradition arrangement between Indonesia and say Singapore or other countries? But at least the allegation is there's a lot of Indonesian money, dirty Indonesian money, yeah, in Singapore. So whenever you walk down Orchard Street and there's beautiful building and pavement, you should realize that this is Indonesian money behind it. Just the same as if you go to Rotterdam, yeah, or Breda or Amsterdam, a lot of the pavement have been built with Indonesian money 200 years ago. So more or less the same kind of, I mean, I'm just joking, of course. So maybe who wants to start?
Let me, because this is more related to the individual country than yeah. ASEAN as a whole, first on an energy policy, energy, what it's called energy security, kemandirian energy. It is, first of all, it's depend on Indonesia. There should be political wills on how the previous government, also I think the present government, to develop this alternative energy. Look to the Brazil, from the sugar cane, they could produce alcohol, you know. Then they converted it to biofuel. I don't know how here, the lot of discussion, I don't know in English, jarak, pohon jarak. But there is no movement on how, you know, we develop a kind of the pohon jarak plantation, perkebunan pohon jarak. And also on how we could make the conversion from the palm oil. We are number one in the world in terms of producing the palm oil, and Malaysia number two. But there is no any movement on how we could convert the palm oil into the biofuels. Because this is the debate, we follow the debate in the television, I think the Indonesian Lawyers Clubs before, on the dissolution of the petrol, yeah. The discussion on the dissolution. The discussion on how we should not be dependent on the importation of the fuels from crude oil from the other countries, especially from Singapore. This is the debate, you know, it's related to the corruption also. So I think Faisal Basri could answer this. I'm not entitled, I think, to it. But I think if you follow this, the discussion, you know, on how we should do develop this alternative energy, there should be any political wills. So then with regard to the money now in Singapore, Indonesian money, Indonesian corruptions money that they be deposited in Singaporean bank, I think a lot of discussion now, the Ministry of Finance, especially Director General of Taxation now, want to introduce the waiver on how, you know, to give pengampunan, yeah, waiving for those who, you know, amnesty for those who has lot of money outside the country, then they bring back the money into Indonesia. The problems, first of thing, I think we should clear in our backyard, you know, on how we could prevent the corruption within the country. This is the first place. It's our fault. And then the second one, on how to negotiate with Singapore. So far, we don't sign extradition treaty with Singapore and Singaporean government, because Singapore introduced the linkage between the signing of the extradition treaty along with the defense treaty, because Singapore at the times want to use Natuna Islands as the exercise for their army, military exercise. They use military exercise. And we rejected it because Natuna is rich with natural gas. If something happened, you know, we don't know if there was invasion from outside, the military invasion from outside, they know already the situation, the terrain in Natuna Island. That's why we refuse the linkage between the signing of the extradition treaty along with the defense treaty, especially for the military exercise in Natuna Island. That is why up to now the disagreement in limbo between Indonesia and Singapore. I don't know whether we will be in the future. But the Indonesian parliament at the time, while I was still active, they refused also. Indonesia go along with the signing of both this agreement, defense agreement, as well as also the extradition treaty.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Temsak, would you like to add to the ASEAN side of the story?
Well, I'm not an expert on energy, but I believe in Europe, they use a lot of nuclear energy. Renewable energy seem to play very small part in any European economy, I think. So in ASEAN, maybe the future will be in nuclear energy. That's one thing. Talking about corruption, I think that is another issue that in ASEAN, ASEAN has no effective cooperation to combat corruption, although we say it will be good if we can cooperate, but nothing has been done just yet.
I see. Probably because it would be not in the interest of the leaders, some of them, if corruption was eradicated on an ASEAN scale, probably. Maybe you can bring the EU perspective on this corruption and energy policy. Or maybe you want to choose one.
Well, let me start with the energy story. Energy policy is actually much more than what you said about biofuel. Energy policy is about almost everything. The EU policy on a general level is, I would say, the gold standard globally in energy policy, insofar as the European Commission, that is the executive branch, the government of the EU, has brought up a policy, ambitious policy called 20-20-20, which means by the year 2020, about 20% of our energy consumption should come from renewable sources, and greenhouse gas emissions should be reduced by 20%. Meanwhile, this 2020 has been raised upward, so we are even more ambitious now. And in December this year, you will hear from the climate conference in Paris that the EU will set a new standard. The mix of energy in the EU is still up to each member state. So somebody said nuclear energy, that's correct. I think, Contemsak, you mentioned nuclear. I think France is about 40% nuclear. My own country, Austria, is, I think, the world market leader in terms of renewable. 35% comes from hydropower and wind, and others are in between, depending on your own resources. The main source of energy, and this is a lesson for ASEAN, the main source of energy is not wasting it. When you look outside the windows from this tower, you will look at Sudirman, you will see how much it is, and you will see how many tons and tons and tons of fuel are being burned and being spent and wasted for nothing because there is no public transport. All of a sudden, it comes to mind that energy policy is about public transport, among other things. Okay? So energy policy actually is much bigger, and the EU tries to be ambitious and comprehensive in its energy policy.
Thank you. What about corruption? I mean, do you have extradition among
EU countries?
Yes, well, you have, let's say, the criminal code is still the competence of individual member states. Okay. You have only a top element for very serious crimes where you have an EU rule, like an extradition or a European arrest warrant, which is for very serious stuff. Corruption is not one of those. Therefore, you would rely on bilateral agreements. In the EU, we have reduced the bank secrecy to a minimum over the last 10, 15 years, and it is precisely to root out corruption. There are actually two major models in operation. One is to tax interest revenues at the source, that you can remain anonymous. If you have a bank account in Germany, being a Portuguese, you can keep it there and you will earn interest, but the bank in Germany will take away automatically 35% of your interest as a tax. Or the other model is to make it open and to repatriate your interest back to Portugal, and then you declare it as a tax revenue.
But if the bank in Germany issues the tax voucher, yes, meaning it has been taxed in Germany,
correct,
you can show this to your Portuguese authorities.
And you won't be taxed again.
You won't be double taxed.
Right.
Okay. Let me add to this discussion a bit. Yeah. The most recent discussion between our Ministry of Finance and the Singaporean Ministry of Finance was for Indonesia to Indonesia was asking the Singaporean authority to open up its banking books. Now, Singapore said, we are going to agree with that if you do the same. And therein lies the problem. Because Indonesia has a banking secrecy law. Yeah, meaning that the police or whoever, if they want to go in and have a look at the bank account of an individual in Indonesia, you have to have very long procedure. The Minister of Finance himself has to sign it, and then some other police officials have to sign it, and so on and so forth. So, of course, we are not going to open our books to their scrutiny. So why should they open their books to our scrutiny? So I'm not sure whether this Finance Minister of Singapore is just being very very smart, yeah, looking at our weakness, or is it really true that they are going to actually open their books to our scrutiny if there is a case? Yeah, this guy has to be a convict first. Yeah, and there's a court order for the banking authority to open up their bank accounts. I think that is a normal procedure in Indonesia. And if you have that and you bring it to Singapore, they will also do the same. But only if they can do the same to us. So probably this is something that ASEAN might want to look into. Yeah, I mean, at least you are going to make it difficult for criminals or corrupt officials to move their money among ASEAN countries, but they can easily move to Hong Kong, I guess.
Then
in that case, you should already have some kind of extradition with Hong Kong. Then the criminal is always one step ahead of the police. Yeah. So we have about 3 minutes to go. Last question from Ambassador of Brunei, please. Sir.
Hello. Yeah, I'm not the ambassador.
You're not the ambassador.
No, okay. The charge d'affaires. Okay. Actually, this is not going to be a question, but if you can indulge me, can I do a quick survey with the group here?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Selamat sore semua. Nama saya Nasri. This is related to identity and how we identify ourselves as ASEANs or Indonesians. Okay. Saya mau tanya dari kalian semua ya. Dari kalau saya tanya ya 100 saya, antara kamu 100% identitas kamu kepada Indonesia atau 75% Indonesia, 25% ASEAN, 50% Indonesia, 50% ASEAN, 25% Indonesia, 75% ASEAN atau 100% ASEAN. Di kalian rasa kamu sendiri. Sila angkat tangan kalau kamu rasa kamu 100% Indonesia, 0% ASEAN. Lo angkat tangan.
Yang 100% Indonesia,
yang 100% Indonesia, 0% ASEAN.
Nah, silakan. Ini ada Bapak di sini satu.
Ya, satu. Oke. Kira-kira hampir setengah ya. 75% Indonesia, 25% ASEAN. Sekira 15-10 ya. 50% Indonesia, 50% ASEAN. Oke, 1, 2. 75% ASEAN, 25% Indonesia. 1. 100% ASEAN. Enggak ada. Tidak ada ya. And that's my point.
Okay.
In what? No. And what I'm saying is, in Europe, the identification of Europeans with their nationality is, and in some countries like Germany, is 50% and above. Right? Okay, we can just debate, but it's significantly higher. Mm. What I'm saying is, in this case, what's ASEAN has always been criticized as, it's often been criticized as a diplomatic gathering with no connections towards the public, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I'm not talking on behalf of my country here. I'm talking on behalf of my personal here. So please don't quote me on this, okay? I still need my job.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay? So what I'm trying to say here is that the case true for ASEAN? Mm. And how is the EU managed to put itself in a position where the community of the EU, the people of the EU, feel themselves at least equitable as a member, a citizen of EU, and as well as their nation state? Which currently, we're talking about in the youth, the new generation of ASEAN here, of Indonesia here, which Indonesia has traditionally been the driver of ASEAN, right? These are people who are cosmopolitan, very educated in most cases. But yet, we only find very few who identify themselves as more than ASEAN. And we're talking about the cosmopolitan. We're not talking about, as Bapak said, those who are in East Java living in the farmlands who don't even know what ASEAN is. If we can't get them to identify to ASEAN, how do we even take the next step to a community? Or is this just community is just a name? Thank you.
Thank you. Sure. Feel free. But only a minute, please.
1 minute.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I very much strongly agree with what you said at the end. You need to create an ASEAN identity. And believe me, in Europe we are trying to do the same with European citizens, to give them a sense of identity. Where I tend to disagree with what was with your initial statement about the percentage points, because identities can overlap, and you can be 100% taxpayer, male, wearer of eyeglasses, Brunei citizen, ASEAN citizen, world citizen, a traveler, a tourist, a husband, a father. All these identities come together. Every and each of those identities is 100% in a given situation. You pull out your identity hat according to the situation. Therefore, it's not a contradiction. What you said is very much some that you hear in Europe from the UK, for instance, where they say, well, if we are stronger committed to the EU, it takes away something from our Britishness. I think this is fundamentally not the case. Mm. You can be 100% British and 100% European at the same time. And I think if you combine these two ideas, you can happily create an ASEAN identity or work towards an ASEAN identity without giving up your Indonesia-ness or Thai-ness or Brunei-ness. You add it, and it's an enrichment. It doesn't take away anything. It makes you a better person.
Thank you, Andreas. I think we have run out of time, so
I would like to thank our host, the people from Ad America, Mr. Andreas, Mr. Termsak, in Singapore, and I hope you're in Singapore, right?
Yes.
Yeah, currently, I hope, yeah. And Mr. Ibrahim Yusuf, and also the people who asked the questions, and all the attendants. I don't have what you would call it a summing up to do, yeah, because this is a very big issue, and all the speakers have made very good points. But what I would like to say is that the last thing that Mr. Andreas mentioned, I would like to re-emphasize that. Being ASEAN citizen doesn't mean you become less of an Indonesian citizen. In fact,
that's a very important point.
Yeah,
very
in fact, you may point, you may become more of an Indonesian citizen if you become ASEAN. Yeah, I think the sense of community is something that we need to build on. Yeah, and it's not just the leaders talking. It's the people now talking, yeah? So all of you should take some kind of interest in ASEAN or related materials, and hopefully we can become stronger together. Yeah. Thank you again for the speakers. A big round of applause for them. I hand it back to the organizers.
Terima kasih, Pak Moderator dan para pembicara. Berikutnya kami mengundang Pak Imbang, CEO Bakrie Center Foundation, untuk menyerahkan plakat kepada pembicara. Yang terhormat, Pak Imbang.
Sekali lagi boleh tepuk tangan untuk para pembicara dan juga moderator kita pada hari ini. And as our tradition, I would like to invite all the speakers and also the moderator to take picture with Ad America logo. Okay, sekali lagi terima kasih. Thank you so much for coming to this event. Don't forget to check out our other events on our website www.atamerica.or.id. Jangan lupa buat cek website kami dan datang ke acara-acara selanjutnya. Dan bagi teman-teman di sini yang tadi belum registrasi, harap registrasi di luar. Sudah ada di meja registrasi, bisa diisi namanya untuk mendapatkan sertifikat. Dan we also have...